Good afternoon. I want to extend my deepest gratitude for the opportunity to speak to you today. Moral injury is such a deeply profound and personal topic that I rarely speak of it directly in regards to my own life, as this can be a somewhat painful experience in and of itself. It is even rarer for an audience to gather for the explicit purpose of listening to an account of moral injury. For me, this is a most sacred event. It is not sacred because I am speaking in particular, although that certainly makes this more personal for me. It is a sacred event because it is such a counter-narrative to the narrative in which we are immersed most of the time. So many veterans suffer because of their experiences in war, and whether or not they would name their suffering moral injury, or if they suffer in some other way altogether, many suffer alone and in silence. Most will never get the opportunity to speak about their experience openly, because moral injury and the ramifications of our wars on both individual and collective conscience are still topics that much of the public wishes to avoid. Let us not forget that politicians, corporations, leaders in public and private spheres are often both actively and subtly engaged in encouraging us to forget the consequences of war. Dwelling on them tends not to produce wealth, goods, or votes. Sometimes we are not encouraged to forget, but rather the meanings of war, the meanings of military power, and the meanings of what it is to serve in the military are constructed for us, and we are expected to accept those meanings with no questions asked. So I say again, this is a sacred event. It's sacred because you have made it sacred by being here, by being willing to listen and to make meaning for yourselves. Thank you for taking this time to listen to me. Thank you for making this event sacred. When you leave, remember what it felt like to listen to counter-narratives, to grapple with others' experiences that are not your own. I intend to share with you what moral injury means to me. I am one veteran, speaking for myself. There are many here with different experiences, and there are so many more suffering in silence out there. Seek them out. Make other places sacred by listening to them and making new and life-giving meaning alongside them. I was enlisted in the Army from 2002 through 2006 as an explosive ordnance disposal specialist. I deployed once to Iraq in 2004 for 6 months. At the launch of the Soul Repair Center at Brite Divinity School 2 years ago, I was given the chance to reflect publicly about the experience. I said then that I could no longer objectively speak about my experience returning home from Iraq. I said that I experienced war once in a specific time, in a specific place, and that I still come to grips with the fact that I have the rest of my life to ponder the consequences, ramifications, and the meaning of my involvement in that conflict. Had I been asked in September of 2004, when I came home, to give a concise report on what it meant to return home from war, I would not have been able to give a complete and satisfactory answer even then. This remained true when I spoke at the Soul Repair Center launch. It remains true now. A full decade stands between me and my experience in Iraq, and the meaning of the war and my involvement in it still fluctuates over the course of time. While in Iraq, choices and actions were made quickly. There is not much time for reflection in the midst of this fast tempo, mission-oriented way of living. Now, I am in seminary, and most of my days are filled with thinking and reflection, and very few actions and choices are made with a sense of urgency. This is not an altogether pleasant experience. I recently had the pleasure of catching up with one of the soldiers from my unit, my old unit. He's deployed multiple times over the last decade to both Iraq and Afghanistan, and I hadn't seen him since 2005. He happened to be in San Antonio last year on business, and I was excited to drive down and talk to him again. We're sitting in a mall food court, chatting about what we've been up to over the years. Basic stuff like daily routines, hobbies. And in the midst of the conversation, he said something very compelling, something that I think has much to say about moral injury, though that's not what we were talking about. He said, "I haven't slept much since the wars started." I recall not sleeping much when I returned from Iraq for quite a few years. I couldn't sleep because I was bothered, disturbed. I was bothered by the war, and I was bothered with the process of attempting to re-enter a civilian consumer-driven atmosphere upon my return. I was bothered by a feeling I could not quite name. It's the feeling that kept me from sleeping, the feeling that I suspect keeps many from sleeping. Moral injury is a name for it, or at least a name for one aspect of it. But what does that mean, exactly? For me, moral injury names the disillusionment, the erosion of my perception of my place in the world. It's the removal of the spiritual and emotional foundations of being in the world that allow me the capacity to sleep the so-called sleep of the just. It's having been a part of something like war, which is so much bigger than me, but feeling personally responsible for the consequences of it, long after I've distanced myself from the war. It's a feeling of intense betrayal, and the betrayer and the betrayed are the same person, my very self. When I speak of disillusionment, I want to clarify that I am not disillusioned with the fact that the United States military can and will meet specifically identified mission objectives. Nor have I become disillusioned of my admiration and love for my sisters and brothers with whom I served. The word friends does not begin to adequately describe how I feel about those people. But what began to erode for me in Iraq in 2004 and what I continue to be disillusioned with over time is my younger self's perception of good and evil. It's the best way I can describe moral injury. It's a painful transition from a world and way of being in the world which makes moral sense to a world that does not. I want to share with you a scene from one of my favorite movies that illustrates this point well. There's a 1966 movie called A Man for All Seasons. It's a romanticized account of the life of Sir Thomas More, and it's his dealings with King Henry VIII in 16th century England. King Henry is trying to find a way to divorce his wife and remarry without the consent of the Roman Church. Thomas More, a trusted friend of the king, who also holds the political position of Lord Chancellor, finds himself in a morally compromised situation. It is clear from the audience's perspective that More disapproves of the divorce. However, he seeks to maintain silence on the issue, not publicly approving or condemning the king's wishes. Moore's soon-to-be son-in-law, William Roper, can't understand why Moore remains silent And so this argument ensues over who deserves the benefit of the law. Roper, the son-in-law, asks Moore, "So now you give the devil the benefit of the law?" And Moore says, "Yes, what would you do? Cut a great road through the law to get after the devil?" Roper, "Yes, I'd cut down every law in England to do that." And here's the important part. This is what Moore has to say. "Oh, and when the last law was down and the devil turned round on you, where would you hide, Roper? The laws all being flat. This country is planted thick with laws from coast to coast, humanity's laws, not God's. And if you cut them down, and you're just the man to do it, do you really think you could stand upright in the winds that would blow then?" "Yes, I'd give the devil the benefit of the law for my own safety's sake." This is what moral injury is. It's the winds that blow when all the laws and all the rules and all the understood ways of relating to other human beings have been laid flat. You see, when we release the terms good and evil upon the world and we start applying those terms to human beings and whole people groups, we allow ourselves the capacity to lay flat any moral qualms in order to pursue the enemy to the ends of the earth. When I was 19 years old and I left for war, I left a world that made sense. It was a world where people respected other people's lives and dignity. It was a world where violence and murder were acts that were to be punished, understood to be wrong. And I was a willing participant in the war because I understood then that the so-called enemy was evil. And in that case, all bets are off. For the sake of that pursuit, we start ignoring little things. Little things like children missing limbs because of the conflict. Things like non-combatants being pulled from their homes in the dead of night, black bags placed over their heads, and escorted to a prison compound with no avenue for recourse or appeal. Violence in this wartime scenario is no longer a bad thing. Temporarily, it's sought after as a quality of character. And there's the rub. Such a shift in thinking, such a monumental shift in one's perception of the world cannot be temporary. I expected to be able to come home and return to all those solid foundations and rules and understandings of moral truths. But when I turned around from war in order to come home, what I saw behind me was everything laid flat. I returned, like so many others, to sleepless nights, to thoughts and memories of war. Those disturbing thoughts and memories blew like the wind, and there was no moral shelter with which to protect myself. It had all been laid flat. Can we heal from that? I'm not sure. I sleep well nowadays. I think part of the reason is the distance in time and space between me and the war. Part of it is because I've become adept at not thinking about it. Part of it's come from equipping myself with theological tools for reflecting on my experience. Mostly, though, I think I've simply become used to the winds blowing. I think moral injury is like one of those serious wounds that can be treated, but never quite heals all the way. It's like when someone complains of arthritis or an old injury when it's rainy and gloomy outside. There's something about the air sometimes that just makes it hurt worse. It manifests in strange ways, like spontaneously crying tears of rage while driving to the store. These tears seem to bubble up from no place. Maybe it's not being able to look a family member in the eye after she's thanked you for your service. Sometimes it's my heart shattering all over again. When I see children in the youth group I work with who are surrounded by loving parents, church members, and lives full of opportunity, and my mind wanders back to children in the streets of Baghdad, constantly asking me for candy. Children who literally grew up in the midst of violent war. And that's a big difference, I think, between veterans and civilians. I know plenty of people who feel terrible about certain aspects of our involvement in these long wars. However, the veteran, or at least I, can't quite clearly distinguish the war as something out there or in the past. It's like something I own personally. Sometimes I feel that it is not only by my own actions, but by the war as a whole with which I am condemned. And I don't mean condemned in some cosmic sense. I mean that I condemn myself. It is the paradox of having the war as such a formative experience in my adult life and my refusal to acknowledge that the war can be a part of my life that morally injures me. Of course, the war is a part of me. I cannot avoid it. I cannot escape my experience. And yet who I am rejects what war is and what I was in war. This creates the most surreal experience of being uncomfortable in my own skin. It is important for me that I reemphasize what exactly it is about war that I categorically reject. It is this unleashing of good and evil as fundamental ways of understanding human beings. It is the notion that we can place ourselves on a moral high ground, and having done so, completely disregard any moral obligation to avoid violence and death dealing. It is the laying flat of all the ways of valuing life that we hold dear, with the expectation that we will be able to rebuild those values later. The fact is, it's nearly impossible to rebuild and reclaim all that is lost in war. I began these comments by reminding you that I am one veteran, speaking from the vantage point of my own singular experience. I also mentioned how meaning is often constructed for us, and we're expected to accept it. It's very important to me that my own experience with war and moral injury is not taken to be descriptive of veterans' experience in general. Like any identity marker we use, there are as many meanings of the name veteran and the experience of moral injury as there are veterans who experience it. I cannot speak for those who are silent, and no one can. I encourage you, every once in a while, to turn off the news networks. Take a moment to separate yourself from all the meanings that are thrust onto us from so many sources, and let your mind wander. Let your eyes and ears drift back over the past 13 years or so, and all that has transpired. What was there before, and what remains? Over what and over whom do the winds blow?